Good afternoon and welcome to NASA's Kennedy Space Center. I've been waiting 2 years to say this, but welcome to everyone as we have our post-launch press conference. And congratulations to everybody up here and the teams that have worked hard on this for the last 2.5 years. We're going to have some brief remarks from our folks up here, and then we'll go to questions. Again, I'd like you to, as standard procedure, please identify yourself and your affiliate before asking a question. Let me introduce our briefing members today. To my left is Michael Griffin, NASA Administrator. To his left, William Reedy, Associate Administrator for Space Operations. To his left, Bill Parsons, Space Shuttle Program Manager. To his left, Wayne Hale, Deputy Program Manager for the Space Shuttle Program. And to his left, Mike Leinbach, Shuttle Launch Director. As I said, a few brief remarks, and then we'll get to some questions. Mr. Administrator.
Thank you, Dean, and thanks to all of you here. I'll keep my opening remarks brief, but I want to use them to ask you all to take note of what you saw here today. The power and the majesty of the launch, of course, but also the competence and the professionalism, the sheer gall, the pluckiness, the grittiness of this team that pulled this program out of the depths of despair 2.5 years ago and made it fly. I want you to think about what it takes to get millions of different parts from thousands of vendors across the country to work together to produce what you saw here today, to realize how chancy it is, how difficult it is, at what a primitive state of technology it still is. And this team managed to do it, and I think a large debt of appreciation is due to them. They have worked as hard as any team in NASA history to get what you, to produce what you saw today. Thank you.
Amen. This has been a total team effort since the very beginning, 2.5 years ago, and as all of you have followed along with us, it's been a struggle, a constant struggle, to overcome an awful lot of things. What you didn't see out on the launch pad today was the fact that Atlantis is stacked in the VAB ready to go. We've accomplished a tremendous amount, but this is the launch. We've got 12 days of orbit operations to do, and then we've got to get Discovery and her crew safely back home. I think today Mother Nature smiled on us, and I also think the Columbia crew smiled on us. We owe them and their families a debt of gratitude. The entire NASA family does. And to get Eileen and her crew up safely in orbit today with a pristine vehicle and a superb count, I just can't say enough good things about the team that I've been fortunate to be associated with. Bill?
I'd just like to send a personal thanks to all our shuttle program folks, the NASA workers, the contractors, the NASA centers that jumped in and helped us out, solved so many technical problems. You just can't believe what an effort this was for this agency, and I can't tell you how much support this program got in our effort. And I just echo what Bill said. We still got some work to do, and then we'll bring the crew home safely, and we'll fly another one. So I really, again, I just can't tell you what this means today.
I don't know how to begin. This is my heart's been in my throat all morning. And a great day, and to think that here we are today with Americans back in flight on an American vehicle is just a tremendous step, and it'll be the first in many steps as we head out into the exploration of the solar system back to the moon and on to Mars. And then this team showed a kind of spirit and dedication to overcome difficulties that is going to take, and I couldn't be more proud of them. It's a great day.
Times like this, I get to represent the launch team and really all of Kennedy Space Center. And I just wish you all could have been in the lobby of the Launch Control Center when we were enjoying our beans and cornbread that we hadn't enjoyed in over 2.5 years. The mood was just giddy. People were just slapping each other on the back. And there will only be one thing better than today's launch, and that will be the landing in 12 days.
All right, that'll be it for our opening remarks. We'll now take questions, and please identify yourself and your affiliate. Let's go right here in the blue shirt, Jay Barbary.
Jay Barbary with NBC. First, let me ask you a question as a journalist. Did you see any debris or anything come off today in your early take? And as a non-journalist who has covered all 145 missions, magnificent, okay? Did you see any debris?
Yeah, well, let me just say, I talked with the two senior members of the photo imagery group that were on their way to review the imagery. It's a little early to make comments on what's going on. You know, you have to have some experience and some knowledge to be able to interpret the photography. I did get an early report before we left the firing room from the radar team that said they saw no tracks prior to SRB-SEP. And of course, at SRB-SEP, we put off booster covers and different things that we know come off. So, so far, I think the best shot was that shot of the external tank looking back at the orbiter as it flew away, and it looked really good. We'll have to see, though. The guys are going over that frame by frame. And tomorrow, you know, we'll have a better story for you.
All right, along the wall, let's go with Mike Cabbage.
Mike Cabbage with the Orlando Sentinel. To follow up on Jay's question, it appears someone is not an expert, certainly, from watching the film from the ET camera that right after the solid rocket boosters separate, that there's clearly some kind of a debris event. It doesn't appear to strike the orbiter, but it does look like it's a large piece of debris. Have you gotten any additional information on what that could be, where it could have come from, or what's going on with it?
No. We don't have waiting for the experts to come back and tell us.
All right. Next question, right there in front.
Simon with KHWB TV in Houston. The sensors work today. What's your reaction to that, and do you feel like you could finally put this to bed as an unexplained anomaly, as you call it?
Is that for me?
That's for you. That's fine.
I'm a little disappointed. I'll be very honest with you. Having worked through the rationale and satisfied ourselves right up to including me that we were good to go with three of four, I said the other day, and I meant it, I wanted the one that failed the other day to fail again, because we had some diagnostic procedures in place today, and maybe we could have removed the U from the UA and turned it into an EA, and that would have been nice to do. So now we're in the position that I think Mike Linebach said earlier, we have an unexplained resolution. And I guess that's good, but engineers don't like the unexplained, and now the evidence is, or at least half the evidence is gone, never to be seen again.
All right, let's stay back along the wall. Tracy.
Tracy Watson, USA Today, I guess for Mr. Hale. Were you relieved to see by the end of the countdown that the sensors were all working right?
It's always good to have a clean vehicle where everything's working right. So, yes, I was very pleased. I kind of thought that might happen. So,
I'll tell you, we had a very detailed troubleshooting plan that we ran through today, and try as we might, we were not able to make an eco-sensor fail today. So it was a good feeling.
Worked hard at it, huh?
Yeah, that's right.
Second row, blue shirt, Tom.
Thank you very much. Tom Costello from NBC News. Was there anything at all today that didn't go as picture perfect as it appeared to have gone to all of us watching and both on the ground and also on television? Was there anything, any glitches, anything that didn't go right?
I talked to Mission Control just a couple minutes before I came over here, and there is one temperature sensor that has become erratic.
What does that mean?
Not much. One out of hundreds.
And I'll tell you, from the launch countdown perspective, it was a very, very clean countdown. We had some liquid nitrogen dripping out of the ground umbilical carrier plate, which connects to the external tank, the hydrogen vent arm at the end of the hydrogen vent arm. But we've seen that before. And really, that was the biggest thing we talked about. We were waiting for the ECOs to rear their heads, and they never did. So from my perspective, it was a very, very clean countdown.
Right up front, right here in the Stefano for Time Magazine. Mr. Weinbach, you literally picked up the pieces of Columbia, put them together, You were also launch director for that launch, and today you are probably experiencing the high of having launched another shuttle safely. Can you just give us tell us how you feel? I mean, all of these highs and lows.
It's been a ride for the whole shuttle program. I saw a close friend of one of the Columbia crew that was lost after launch. I saw her down in the lobby, and we embraced, and it was a very special moment. She helped me in the hangar when we were putting the debris together. So for her especially, it was very important. But really for the whole team, we've come almost full circle. We have a 12-day mission ahead of us and a landing, and then we can claim we've come full circle.
Second row, green shirt, Ralph.
Ralph Artabedi in Los Angeles Times. Now that you've got a successful launch, do you feel that there is any lasting damage in terms of the public support or your confidence in the Columbia accident? Or, as you say, have you come full circle and now you're firing again on all eight cylinders and it's all history?
I think that it was a misnomer that public support ever flagged during the downtime. Matter of fact, immediately after the accident, I think people recognized that we're in a very risky business and it's very important. During the downtime, we even had the solicitation for the educator astronauts. That was at an all-time high. I think we've got 19 billion websites. That was earlier this week and probably after the launch today. It shows that there's always been a tremendous amount of public support, and I think the vision for space exploration has helped ignite that. This is the first step on the way to doing that, the return to flight, getting the station built, moving on beyond low Earth orbit, and getting them back to the moon and on to Mars. I think people endorse that, people around the world. It's one of the nobler things that we do on behalf of all mankind, and people appreciate that. So I disagree with your initial premise. I think the support's always been there. It's probably higher today than it's been in some time. You know, you're never, never as good as you are until your next launch. You know, that's the operations business that we're in. Is you're always working on that next launch, and you can never let down your guard. And I think that was one of the lessons we learned after Columbia, is it takes eternal vigilance to do what we do. And there isn't anything easy about it. And I'll guarantee you, knowing the people that are lined up here on the dais with me and the people they represent around the NASA family, there isn't anything easy about this on any given day. And the fact that Discovery was so clean today is a tribute to all the folks that worked since August of 2001 to put that vehicle back together piece by piece by piece. And it was pristine today when we went to go launch, and I think Eileen and her crew have got the best vehicle we've ever fielded, and Atlantis is going to be equally good when it goes flying in September.
Front row right here in the white shirt.
Mike Schneider, Associated Press. I know you all are related about the pristine launch, but I was wondering if the celebration has been muted compared to past launches because of the uncertainty about the next 12 days.
Well, surely. I mean, the first thing you learn as a student pilot is that the flight's not over until the engine is shut off and the airplane's tied down. And we have, as Mike Leinbach said, 12 more days plus before we achieve that state. And that's when we'll know that this was a safe flight.
I'd have to add, this is a difficult mission. We still have a lot of complex maneuvers to do. We still have a lot of test objectives to meet. And we still have a lot out in front of us. And this team, although we were very proud and very elated to see the launch today and see how well the countdown went and everything else, there's still a lot of work in front of us. And so this team will come together after this, and they'll get head down and start coloring again, because there's still a lot of work to do.
Yeah, I think Wayne will probably vouch for the fact that this is a very, very ambitious mission, and it was so ambitious that during return to flight, we decided to separate it into two flight tests. So we've got a tremendous amount of work ahead of us, and it's a very complex mission. I think the crew is probably the best trained crew we've ever flown even including Captain John Young and Buck Crippen. I think Eileen and her crew have been in training for this mission since 2001. So this is the best trained crew that we've probably ever had, but it's also probably one of the most complex test missions we've ever attempted. And this is just the first half.
Okay, let's go right here in the front row, John.
John Kelly with Florida Today. Wayne, what's the MMT schedule, if you could help us out here? Are you guys going to get any kind of film analysis tonight, or will you not start meeting until tomorrow, and what's your first steps here?
Most of the film team is going to be reviewing those films for the next 12 hours or so. We'll get, as an MMT, a quick look tomorrow morning early, and then our regular schedule of MMT meetings will be 1 in the afternoon Central Time for the duration of the flight. And I think we have promised to come talk to you folks almost every day, if not every day, to tell you what we know. And we'll be here to let you know on a daily basis.
Let's go under the row, white shirt.
Hi, Ben O. Schmidt, High Definition News. I'm wondering if you, with the luxury of hindsight and what appears a successful launch, if you can talk a little bit again, and this is for Wayne, about how the decision was made to go ahead and launch with an unexplained anomaly and what that might mean to Atlantis and other shuttles, and also, you know, how hard it was to replicate launch conditions in a lab.
Well, of course, there are a couple of things that you can't replicate until you get into a launch countdown, one of which is the thermal environment. You've got to load the cryogenics in the tank to get everything chilled down to those temperatures, which certainly can affect electronics or the wiring. The other thing that's very difficult to emulate is some of the potential electromagnetic interferences. And until you get all the equipment on and all the power up in the ship, you know, we did what we thought were the big potential contributors to that, but until you have everything on all at once and you're getting the full power draw through the system, you don't know how it's going to affect it. So really we had to get into this launch countdown configuration to really do the final test, if you want to call it, of how these sensors were going to work. I would say that the decision that led up to proceeding to launch with less than full up set of sensors was extremely thorough. Was not taken lightly, was very heavily studied, heavily debated, lots of technical analysis and input went into it. It was not a snap decision. It was well-reasoned, and I think that it was a good plan. I'm glad we didn't have to execute it, and I will tell you that after we'll stop on Discovery, we'll think about what it means to Atlantis and the subsequent flights, but probably not before then. We have plenty to do to keep us busy until we get the Discovery crew back home safe.
Third row, pink shirt, Guy.
Guy Gugliotta for the Washington Post. For Wayne, does that mean that you won't make a decision on whether to fly with three for Atlantis until this mission is done, or has that decision already been made?
No, I'll repeat. We're probably not going to talk anything more about eco sensors until after the flight's over, and then we'll think about the next flight and where it goes. The folks that would be involved in that kind of discussion are heavily involved in the mission activities, and we need to stay focused on that up front.
All right, right here in the third row, green shirt.
Thank you. Greg Dobbs from HDNet. As scientifically as your minds tend to work, would each of you mind telling us just briefly how you felt emotionally during those first 60 seconds?
I don't know. I was watching displays and camera footage, looking for evidence of what we were all looking for, anything coming off the tank, just trying to evaluate what we were seeing from an engineering perspective, realizing, of course, that it wasn't ever going to be as good as all the post-game replays that we will do, but I've. If you want honesty, I've got to be honest with you. I was engaged in what was going on and was not aware of what I might or might not be feeling. I'm sorry.
Somebody has to do it.
Everyone was doing it.
Nobody was. None of you was just taking even a moment to pump your fist and say, "Go, baby, go."
Oh, I'm sure.
There was more emotion in the Launch Control Center than I've seen in all the times that I've been in there for launches. There were people clapping at various stages. There was some emotion in that firing room. So I would just say we were all feeling it, but every time it was just that moment, and then we moved on to again concentrate on what was going on with the launch and trying to see as much as we could and hear as much as we could and understand what was going on. I had Bill sitting next to me, so he was giving me kind of a blow-by-blow of what the crew was feeling, and there's nothing like hearing it from somebody that's done it before. So, Mike, your guys were they were pretty up.
We were pretty pumped. But our job in the control center is not over until we don't have a return to launch site abort, which is about 4.5 minutes into the flight. And so when the launch team kind of did a little cheer at SRB separation, I'm going to have to go back and talk to them about that. because the rules are we don't do that. But nevertheless, it was a human reaction that you could not quell. And then, of course, at MECO and at separation, when we saw the separation for the first time live, was just surreal almost.
All right, right here, second row, white shirt.
Randy Avera, Randolph Publishing. First part for Wayne Hale. Do you have a plan to do any special launch commit criteria reviews prior to the next flight? And for Dr. Griffin, could you tell us a little bit about your strategies for possibly accelerating the return to the moon? Have you thought about that in detail?
Let me answer first. Today is about discovery and about the first of our return to flight missions, and that's all it's about. And I just don't have any comments about anything beyond that. Other topics are going to be for other times.
So the Launch Commit Working Group meets every Monday at 10 a.m. And they will meet every Monday, and they'll talk about all the different things that they talk about. And I'm sure that there may be one or two related meetings about eco-sensors. But again, that'll be after we get Discovery back on the ground.
Third row, blue shirt.
Thank you. Jeff Patterson with WFLA-TV out of Tampa. And this is a question for Mr. Hale. I know you said that there would be a frame-by-frame review of the various camera angles that you have. But have you had a chance to review some of them just from an aesthetic point of view? I mean, the freeframe that you have behind you is beautiful. It almost looks like science fiction. And this has offered a unique perspective, I suppose, not only this angle, but the aircraft that we're flying around. Have you had a chance to look at some of those shots, and what is your assessment just from an aesthetic point of view?
Just from what we saw during the launch, we watching out the window, the great, beautiful, wonderful launch where the rocket seems to just take off right over the Launch Control Center. And then as it went out of sight, turned around and looked at the television and saw this magnificent view of the Earth and the orbiter from the external tank camera, and particularly when it rolled heads up, it was just brought a gasp out from everybody because it was just astounding footage that we'd never seen before. And it's just it's aesthetically wonderful.
And from a crew member standpoint, it's really nice to be able to share some of that. I mean, that's what you see, that's what you experience, and for the team to be able to see that up close and personal this time, I think is magnificent. I was kind of kidding Pat Youngs, who's Eileen's husband, about the fact that Eileen was doing a victory roll on her way to orbit. She just couldn't contain herself. That's kind of how we were feeling about that same time, I think.
All right, a few more questions. Against the wall over there, let's go with Mark. Second.
Thank you, Mark Caro from the Houston Chronicle. I wondered if you could talk about the external tank from the vantage point of the ICE inspection team, if what they saw was what you expected, that kind of condition. And could you tell us a little bit about the camera coverage you got today, not so much the results, but did you have the numbers of cameras working that you needed to do the evaluation you plan over the next several days?
Well, let's see, the inspection of the external tank by the final inspection team, it's the tank, it's the boosters, it's the orbiter, and it's the ground systems also. And it was almost a flawless report. The first time we attempted a launch 10 days or so ago, there was an ice ball that had formed. We expected that ice ball to form again today. It was smaller.
today than we had anticipated, and it was smaller than it was 10 days or so ago. The vehicle was in great shape. It was wet. Water was dripping off of it. Condensation formed. It was a very humid day. But these are all things we've seen many, many times before. And so Armando Oliu, the head of the final inspection team, did his thing and reported virtually a flawless vehicle back to the control center. And we were go at that point from that perspective.
All right, a few more right. Stay back along the wall, maroon shirt.
Thank you. Tarek Malik from Space.com and Space News. I was just curious as to when in this mission, knowing that you have to have some time to process your ground observations, your orbital photography, and the photography from the space station, as well as the sensors along the inside of the wing, when will you have a comprehensive understanding of what the status of this vehicle is after this launch and docking at the space station?
We've laid out a very comprehensive timeline to get all of that back in. As you know, we have, in addition to the video cameras, some of which are regular old-fashioned kind of television cameras and then high-definition television cameras, we have a large number of film cameras that give us very high resolution. That film's got to be sent out and developed. We're going to have film also from the WB-57s, which I'm told tracked all the way from launch through main engine cutoff. So those will be some views that we've never seen before. That'll be about another day before it comes in. We've got cameras also in the solid rocket boosters that those will have to be towed back into Port Canaveral before we can access that videotape and see what's on those cameras. In terms of the sensors in the wing leading edge, that data will be downlinked tonight during the crew sleep period from mission control. And all of this information, plus the radars, plus the other instrumentation, the boom sensor survey they're going to do tomorrow, will come down over the next couple of days. And by flight day 6, we expect to have the full story put together, all the interpretation done, and a complete knowledge of the status of the orbiter.
Stay right in front, right there, Bob.
Bob, from ABC News. The heaters that you added to the shuttle, did you get a sense that they worked? You know, you mentioned that the ice ball was smaller, for example. Did that have anything to do with the heaters at all? I guess not. So did the heaters work? Did you get a sense of how they worked? Did they accomplish what you'd hoped to accomplish?
Well, the one ice ball that we did see form, as Mike described to you, was not in an area where we put the heater. It was really very far down on the tank in an area where we had determined that ice, small amounts of ice in any event, were not of any consequence to us because it was just too far toward the back end of the vehicle to cause a problem. So the heaters that we put on the bipod were absolutely mandatory. I have no doubt that those heaters had no function. Those metal fittings bolted to that cryogenic tank would have been covered with ice, so they absolutely did their job. The heater we put in the LOX feedline bellows, it's hard to say whether it would have been required today. With the heavy condensation that we saw coming down, that tends to keep ice from forming. In any event, that heater was on. We saw no ice, and that was the objective, whether it was the heater did it or whether it was the condensation that kept ice from forming in that area.
All right, we have time for two more questions, and that is it. Let's stay right along there on the wall.
Stephen Young with spaceflightnow.com. I wonder if I could just follow up on Mike's question at the beginning of the news conference. Those of us who watched the ET cam footage saw what appeared to be a fairly noticeable piece come off. I'm just wondering if any of you did see that, whether the camera angles make it look larger, or, you know, I just worry that we might blow this out of proportion before you get a chance to address it after the proper analysis has been done.
Didn't see it. Haven't had a chance to see that one. You know, if you give these guys a chance to take a look at this film and photography, we'll get back with you and tell you exactly what it was. I mean, if there was something there, these guys will find it. So just give us a chance to go take a look. And
I'd say it was up to you guys not to blow it out of proportion.
Right.
I don't have that knob.
I wish I'd have thought of that.
Our guys are going to take a real serious look at the end-to-end footage. In fact, a danger would be possibly seeing something that's very large and visible that we haven't had a chance to look at. and ignore something that would be smaller and more significant. The guys are going to take a professional look at every frame of footage that we have from every camera that we have, because as I've said and others have said several times, these are test flights right now. The primary object under test is the external tank and all of the design changes we made, NASA made, to that tank so that we would never have a repeat of 107.
All right, final question. Let's stay at the very back. Would you please walk over to the microphone?
Dave McDaniel from Western News in Orlando. I know that you went to some detail about explaining that you want to see all this footage and stuff, but the thought that this large piece of debris comes up has to give you some pause and some uneasiness at this point.
Well, let me just say, there are things that we know that come off the vehicle. The paper covers on the RCS thrusters. Some of those come off early, some of them come off late. The photo experts have trained and are practiced in looking at these things to tell whether you're looking at a big thing that's a long way away or a small thing that's close to the camera. I personally have not really looked at the footage. I mean, we kind of halfway watched during the launch, one eye out the window, one eye on the TV screens. So I didn't see it. But the folks that are going through this review are going to look at it very carefully. And if there is something there, you know, we will get back with you. I've got to tell you, too, that we're going to do a very thorough inspection of the orbiter thermal protection system in the next 2 days, first with the boom sensor system tomorrow, and then with the rotation pitch maneuver and the pictures from the International Space Station on the following day. So we are going to know, without a doubt, the status of the thermal protection system before the Discovery crew comes home. And whether there are questions, of course, we haven't had a chance to look at all the film today, so no telling, you know, what might be there or what's not there. We hope nothing.
That'll be the final word. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for covering today's launch, for continuing coverage of the mission, and for continued briefing. Please tune into NASA TV and NASA.gov. Thank you very much, and have a nice afternoon.
This is Mission Control Houston. Discovery is currently 139 statute miles above Spain. As on board, the crew has been given a go for orbit operations. The payload bay doors were opened. The radiators along the interior of the doors activated before that. All of that going very smoothly. The go for orbit operations was passed along to the crew about 11:19 a.m. Central Time, just about 15 minutes ago or so. That was just after the completion of the opening of the payload bay doors performed by the crew. We did receive television of opening of the payload bay doors, via a electronics systems test laboratory here at the Johnson Space Center. It just so happened that Discovery was passing within range of the tracking communications network at JSC during the time of the opening of the payload bay doors. This is a playback of that view that was seen live, again, through a communications station here at the Johnson Space Center. As the payload bay doors were opened aboard Discovery, that operation going very smoothly. Just shortly after that, the crew given a go for orbit operations, which is a formal go to plan for an extended stay in orbit. At the time of door opening, Discovery was above northern Mexico and then Texas and then across the United States northeast before crossing off the Atlantic coast.
Houston, Discovery, blocks 11 and 12 are complete. Block 14 in work.
Copy all, thanks.
Again, this was video received down via a communications and tracking site at the Johnson Space Center of payload bay door opening aboard Discovery. That occurring about 11:19 a.m. Central Time, all going very smoothly. Discovery in excellent health, according to data and mission control, as the crew continues on with setting up shop and preparing for their first night in orbit. Major activities coming up for the crew include a checkout of the robotic arm on board Discovery, that where the arm will be powered up and uncradled briefly to ensure it's working well for the operations it'll be used for in the coming days. That is planned to take place about 12:44 p.m. Central Time. As the arm is powered up and unberthed, also cameras on it will be used to take a look at the KU band antenna and the boom that will be used for inspections of the wing leading edges and thermal protection system of Discovery later during the flight. Although that imagery won't be sent to the ground, that'll be the imagery of the KU band antenna and the boom is being taken just to ensure there's adequate clearance, as has been the case pre-flight. It'll be sent to the ground on flight day 3 for analysis by engineers. The KU band antenna, the antenna that enables much of the television from Discovery during its flight, will not be deployed until about 3 a.m. Central Time on Wednesday. The imaging of the KU band antenna and boom clearance will be seen live by the crew. They can gauge to ensure that operations to deploy the antenna are not a problem. The crew begins their sleep period this afternoon about 3:39 p.m. Central Time. Just before that, at about 3 p.m., they'll also fire Discovery's orbital maneuvering system engines again. To adjust the rate at which Discovery is closing in on the International Space Station, raising Discovery's orbit slightly. This is a live tracking map from the front of the International Space Station flight control room. The station crew, which watched the launch of Discovery live via a special uplink from Mission Control of television and audio, will be going to sleep about 4:30 p.m. Central Time this afternoon. They'll begin some sleep shifting to match the crew of Discovery's wake-sleep cycles tomorrow. The station just about to move into sunrise as it crosses the southern Pacific. Discovery in this view above northern Africa. Discovery closing in on the station. Again, the rate at which Discovery closes in on the station will be slowed about 3 p.m. when Discovery's altitude is raised its orbit moved higher, that having the net effect of slowing the rate at which Discovery is closing in on the station. That'll be the first in a series of engine firings that will culminate in the docking of Discovery to the International Space Station, which remains planned at about 6:18 a.m. Central Time on Thursday.
And Vegas, Houston, you are go for both. As Discovery approaches its second sunset of the past 2 hours that it's been in orbit here in Mission Control, flight control teams are beginning a handover. The ascent entry flight control team that's been on duty for launch under the direction of ascent entry flight director Leroy Kane is in the midst of a handover to the orbit two or second shift flight director Tony Soichi,
who will man that shift throughout the duration of Discovery's flight.
Houston Discovery, we're going to put config control for on orbit pages 1-17 through 1-26 in work.
Copy, we're watching. Handling communications at present with Discovery and during the launch was spacecraft communicator Capcom astronaut Ken Ham. Providing communications for the oncoming flight control shift will be astronaut spacecraft communicator Capcom Julie Payette. The plans for the remainder of the cruise day today are little changed from what they have been pre-flight with Discovery in good health. No systems problems of concern being worked in Mission Control at this time. Among activities coming up will be a checkout of the shuttle robotic arm. That will begin about 12:44 p.m. Central Time by the crew. Working with that, astronauts Andy Thomas and Charlie Camarda. We do anticipate on NASA television at about 1 p.m. Central Time a replay of video taken in Mission Control during the launch of Discovery to orbit this morning. That replay from a handheld camera that was used in Mission Control during launch. That replay, again, anticipated around 1 p.m. Central Time on NASA television. To recap, the crew aboard Discovery opened the payload bay doors just about 11:19 a.m. Central Time. Shortly after that, going very smoothly, Flight Director Leroy Kane gave the crew a go for orbit operations. The point at which the crew is given a go for an extended stay in orbit to plan and continue preparations on board for mission operations. Discovery is currently in an orbit with a high point of 142 statute miles, a low point of about 98 statute miles. That low point of Discovery's current orbit, 98 statute miles, is among the lowest altitudes ever flown by a space shuttle. It's being done for a couple of hours to assist in the rate at which Discovery is catching up with the International Space Station. It's as planned for the standard rendezvous to be flown by Discovery. Discovery will raise its orbit again, with an engine firing plan just before 3 p.m. Central Time, to slow the rate at which Discovery is closing in on the International Space Station. The upcoming engine firing by Discovery, again about 3 p.m. Central Time, will raise that orbital low point to about 141 statute miles, and the high point of Discovery's orbit at 191 statute miles. Discovery will remain in that orbit throughout the duration of the crew's sleep period. The International Space Station is at an altitude of around 225 statute miles. Throughout the next day and a half, as Discovery rendezvous with the station, its orbit will be increased. The shuttle's orbit will be increased until it matches that of the station during the final phase of rendezvous early Thursday morning.
on the flight deck. We're working on the mid deck. We're ready for hydraulic thermal conditioning when you are.
And Vegas, you have a go for high thermal conditioning.
This is Mission Control Houston. This is a live television view from cameras on the International Space Station. The station at an altitude of 225 statute miles approximately. The destination for Discovery now, as over the next 2 days, Discovery will slowly close in on the complex, planned to dock with the station at about 6:18 a.m. Central Time on Thursday. This a live view again of television from the International Space Station, a camera mounted on the exterior of the complex. Directly in front in this view is the Quest airlock, the U.S. Quest airlock of the station. This camera is mounted on the exterior of the station's Destiny Laboratory. Again, this is a live television view from the International Space Station. Station just crossing over Baja, California. Station's course will take it across the central United States and above the Great Lakes area before it moves above Canada and then off the Atlantic coast of North America. On board, Station Commander Sergei Krikalev and Flight Engineer John Phillips are in the latter part of their day. They'll begin their sleep period at about 4:30 p.m. Central Time. The crew on board the station did watch Discovery's launch via a special television uplink done by Mission Control in Houston. They watched it live as Discovery climbed to orbit. As the station crosses above the United States, Discovery at this point is on the nighttime side of Earth above the southern Indian Ocean. Discovery is also at a much lower altitude than the station. The station at a roughly circular orbit of about 225 miles altitude. Discovery currently in an orbit with a high point of 142 miles and a low point of 96 miles, closing in on the station with each orbit of Earth.
Go ahead, Wendy, I'm with you.
Yeah, I'm checking MA-73 Charlie, row echo, AC-2 payload, three phases still out. You want me to push it in?
And stand by, Wendy, I'll get right back to you.
As we watch live television from the International Space Station as it crosses the central United States. We're listening to audio from Discovery and Mission Control as Discovery's crew works toward the next activity for them, a checkout of the shuttle's robotic arm that planned to begin about 12:44 p.m. Central Time. That just to power up the arm, uncradle it, and ensure it is in good working order, ready for its use in the days ahead. In Mission Control, a handover continues of responsibilities in the control center between teams, the ascent entry team.
For Wendy, you have a go to push that circuit breaker in.
Okay, when I complete that, then our mid-deck pages 124, 125, are complete.
Okay, great, thanks.
Then mission control handover continues between the ascent entry flight control team handing over to the orbit 2 or second shift flight control team for Discovery's flight. Progressing, all systems in good shape for Discovery. The plans for the rest of the day for the crew, little change from what they have been prior to Discovery's launch. The standard plan with the crew again checking out the robotic arm, headed toward a sleep period that will begin for them. At about the 3:39 p.m. Central Time this afternoon. Before they begin their sleep period, also at about just before 3 p.m., another engine firing by Discovery, that to adjust the rate at which it's closing in on the station, raising Discovery's current orbit, with the net effect then of slowing down the rate at which Discovery closes in on the station. One note about Discovery's current orbit, it's low point of the current orbit is an altitude of 96 statute miles. That's among the lowest altitudes a space shuttle has ever flown in orbit. That's done to allow a Discovery to catch up on the station as part of its standard rendezvous plan with the complex.
With an update.
And go ahead, Eileen.
Well, we still have a few more things in post-insertion to complete. I'll read those down to you. The quick don mask setup is in work right now. The OCAC will do per the flight plan. This is on page 1-7. The specialist seat removal and stowage is almost complete. On page 1-9, airlock setup for ingress. We'll call that later, and reset caution and warning. Otherwise, the activities in the post-insertion checklist are complete. I'm going to move, some of us will move on to the flight plan, and we're going to start with the easy activities lamp test.
OK, Okay, Eileen, we copy. You have quick don masks, OCAC, later, specialist seat removal in work, and the airlock setup for ingress and resetting caution and warning are going to come later as well. We also have the flight plan open, and you have a go for the lamp test in the easy activities block.
Roger that, and Steve wanted me to let you know that PGSC setup is in work.
Okay, great, thanks.
afternoon, Discovery. Lamp test is complete and good. OIU activation is in work. Step three only.
Copy, we understand. And while I got you, Eileen, from the launch team down here, we have a lot of smiling, happy faces now that the United States is back in the crew launch business. There's some thrilled folks all the way around the world on the launch team. And we appreciate all the work you've done. Tony and Julie are ready to take over and bring you through the Orbit 2 shift.
Well, those are some great words to hear, Ken. We know that the folks back on the planet Earth are just feeling great right now, and our thanks to everybody for all the super work that's been done over the past 2.5 years to get us flying again. And I do want to pass on, from those of us who have flown before, that was by far the smoothest ascent through first stage and up to MECO that we've ever experienced. And the great weather and everything put together, nice ascent with no malfunctions, couldn't ask for a better flight. So thanks to everybody down there on the ascent team, and we're looking forward to seeing you in 12 or 13 days for the entry and landing.
And you got it, Eileen. We'll bring you home safe then.
Houston, this is Julie and Tony Cicchetti and all of Orbit 2. Absolutely delighted and honored to be talking to you for real. And we're ready for step.
Thanks, Julie, and work.
Discovery Houston for CCTV.
Julie, bonjour from orbit. It's Steve. Go ahead.
Steve, bonjour. How you doing? Hey, we have a heads up for you in 15 minutes from now. At 0301, we'll have Dryden video available. And if you wish, you can set up a camera in the flight deck and we can downlink it. So it's at 0301.
0301, and Soichi is in work on that right now. And to answer your question, we are all doing absolutely fantastic. It is just beautiful to be up here with Discovery, and thank you all.
Well, thanks to you, and this is going to be very exciting 13 days, and we'll be following you, Steve, on your network configuration. Keep us to date.
Yes, indeed. That's in work right now on the flight deck. Doug, WLES, and LCS.
Copy that.